have three speakers up next. Mike Insulik, who is an engineer by training and worked for many years at Eastman Kodak, especially in the 90s, where he led the team that developed the Cineon digital film system, which we all know is, was a groundbreaking system for what we do nowadays anyway. And that system led to the development of the DPX file format that was talked about earlier by Steve. More recently, he was president and head of operations at Lowry Digital Images. Joining him will be Alexander Petrikov. He is a professor of mathematics at the University of Georgia. And he joined Alvasoft in 2005 and developed the film restoration technology and software called Viva. Joining them will be Ina Koslov. She is has a PhD in mathematics, and she founded Alvasoft, which is a company that's focused on digital film restoration. So I believe Mike is speaking first, right? So if you welcome, please, Mike Insulik.
Not lost on me that we stand between you and lunch, and we are here to talk about math and deep technology, so we have our work cut out for us, and I'm also going to have my work cut out for us. I'll make sure I get the slides advanced. So What I'm here to do, because I'm not the mathematician of the group, is to try and put this in context, because today's presentation, we're really going to, we're going to dive quite deeply into some of the underlying forces that are changing restoration and providing opportunities for us. We're also going to look at the technologies pretty deeply, but I want to take kind of the bigger picture and look at the fact that, you know, as we know, restoration is sandwiched in between digitizing and creating archival elements, and if we take restoration and deconstruct it further, it really is broken up of essentially a two color correction steps on either end, but then a bunch of image repair in the middle, which can be thought of as some of it being global, affecting the images end to end and their characteristics, and some of it being manual. And I want to talk about this particular part of it because it has a lot to do with where we're going and why. So if we look from left to right, it kind of restates the fact that we start with a pre-grading step in restoration, which is to get us into the viewing environment so that we don't waste our time removing issues you won't otherwise see because of the creative choices of how the movie's supposed to look. And if we look way back, by the way, I talk about the early days here, the first digital restoration at film resolution I'm aware of was done in 1994. In fact, a gentleman sitting in the front row was one of our clients when we restored Disney's Snow White in 4K. Back then, 2 gigabyte disk drive arrays weighed about 40 pounds, and we would move them around, and it would handle about 10 seconds worth of footage. But back in those days, in fact, that was the very first application of image processing. In fact, dust busting was created at that time, and there was both a spatial and a temporal version of this. But basically, about 5% of the entire effort that went into restoration was this automatic processing, and almost everything was manual picking of dirt. And in fact, to be in the restoration business and to hang a shingle, all you really had to do back then was to have a color corrector and a system to allow you to retouch. But our expectations of restoration have changed substantially, and our technologies changed substantially. And one of the issues with a restoration process that's based on a lot of handwork is that it doesn't scale well, and it's very expensive. It's time-consuming, you need qualified artists to do this. Because it's a human intervention, the results aren't consistent. It can't apply to many kinds of problems. And we now have gone from an expectation that restoration is just clean when it comes to dirt and scratches to now expecting the images to be stable, to expecting the images to be flicker-free, for them to have good registration, all of those kinds of things that in fact are virtually impossible to do by hand. And one of the biggest issues here is that a hand-driven way of working in restoration gets more expensive over time because labor rates just don't go down. And here we are globally as archivists with a couple of problems. The first is at the high-end commercial archives, we've restored the most popular, highest value titles. So we're dealing with titles that have lower economic return and have to be done at lower costs. And then we have the problem on a global level and in other kinds of archives where the commercial incentive is not quite the same, but we have literally millions and millions of hours of material to convert, and it is just not practical to do that manually. So the model basically has to change. It has to become much more automatic and much more image processing centric because it's the only way it scales. And one of the things, by the way, that's true, whether or not you're doing pristine restoration or the best restoration you can at a certain budget, is that this automation makes manual work easier. If you've ever had the job of picking dirt, fixing scratches, or doing other manual work, you'll know that if there's flicker, for example, that makes the frames different in luminance, then it's harder to pull pixels from the adjoining frames and use them to repair the frame you're working on because they don't match. Same thing with offsets around stabilization and those sorts of things. So actually, automatic processing helps manual if you're going pristine, and automatic processing can do most of the work otherwise. And the reality here is that automatic processing has come a long way, but it's actually just now kind of kicking in the afterburners, which is what we're going to talk about today. We're able to, with the right kinds of algorithms and the right kind of technologies, essentially replace about 95% of the manual work that needs to be done. Because it's automatic, the repairs are very consistent. You don't add the human element. But the biggest issue here is you're riding on the back of what the computer people call Moore's Law. In fact, we're riding a law that's even faster than that because most of the processing is done in graphics engines, which are actually doubling in speed every 9 months or so. So the work gets cheaper over time rather than more expensive over time. So this is the horse of the future. 15, 20 years ago when we sat around, we were talking about, is digital restoration ever going to overtake analog? And there were lots of reasons to believe that that would happen. That all had to do with computers and their capabilities. This change is just as obvious. We have to move to a very highly computer and automation-centric approach. And what this requires of us is a mindset shift, and that's really what I want to kind of communicate right here. You know, and I'm not trying to imply that manual technology should be looked down on or is inferior. I want to use a transportation analogy to say that when you're doing manual work, it's like getting yourself from your home to the train station, right? Or back from the train station home. It is a one-person, one-transport kind of approach. The automatic work is like the train. We're looking to move lots of people very efficiently from point to point. They are two fundamentally different ways of working. And the reason I bring that up is when we look at how we run workflows and how we execute restoration out there, we have to understand that these are two diametrically opposed approaches. And if you don't build your operation and if you don't build your expectation around how you're going to restore around the fact that automation and handling bulk processing is the way this has to go, you're going to end up with an operation that won't scale into the future the way it needs to. And we see this day in and day out where when we work with customers, they're basically asking for manual features in an automated approach or automated features to go into a manual approach, and we really have to start thinking about them differently. We have to take the train that is automated processing and make it a bullet train. We have to evolve it, right? And if we need to do manual work, we have to turn a bicycle into a super bike, but we have to understand they're fundamentally different and make sure we focus on each of them separately. So The dream of Algasoft, the dream I think of all of us as archivists, is to make this more automated. Our language is this green button that speaks to automatic processing, automatic parameter setting, everything being kind of hands off. That's the ideal goal. You know, there's a treat for us today. We're going to look behind the curtain. You're going to hear from the mathematicians something about what's behind the curtain, right? How this really works. I won't pretend to understand it. In fact, the biggest challenge is this is what we're going to be talking about, and I'm not the person to do that. In fact, if I weren't forced to dress up a little bit today, I'd be wearing my favorite t-shirt, which is this one. And it makes perfect sense to me. It makes perfect sense to me. Now, we're going to try and do this quickly enough so that there's room for questions and answers up front, but I will say I've been asked to kind of preempt one. So within this room, I needed to stay in this room, but I am allowed to confirm that, yes, in fact, you know, we have all our false news, so the whole Russian issue has fallen out of front pages. But yes, indeed, it is true that the Trump campaign did reach out to Alex and Nina through the Russian consulate, asking whether we could please try and restore the image of the candidate. As I think you probably can surmise, they did not take the job on, but instead they will be talking about the restoration work they have been doing, and Alex Petterhoff is going to come up and tell you how this really works.
Introduction. I don't know about general image restoration of candidates, but only about scratches. Actually, not only about scratches. 2 years ago, we presented a new technology, which is called Green Button, because some system which could do a lot of job computing, estimating images, and automatically select better parameters. And it was 2 years ago. 1 year ago, we combined all this Green Button technology with a few more processing modes. Namely, now in one pass we have a super filter which works with degrain, regrain, deflicker, color breathing. Dust removal is there, stabilization is there, maybe sharpening if you want. And why? Why all modes together? There are three reasons. Two of them very good, because, if you have 4K restoration, you need a lot of space. And each output, each extra output is a disaster even for big labs. Second, of course, one pass is faster than sum of a few passes. Maybe it's longer than any of one, but any it's faster. But those two good reasons are not the main. Main reason is because if we run everything together, then different algorithms has ability to exchange information inside. So this is mostly about quality of restoration. If we see it in one pass. Now, vertical scratches are still out of this combo filter, which includes everything. And why? What are principles? How we select passes algorithm for combo filter? We selected because of reliability. If different algorithms became quite reliable, they do not make many artifacts, we can run them together. Otherwise, one algorithm can spoil everything. In this sense, scratch repair is traditionally most complicated problem in restoration, because a lot of variety of scratches are huge. Density of scratches, color of scratches, they are solid, sometimes consist of parts. They have very small measure of image, so to find them is a problem. A lot of objects in images looks like scratches. And we somehow can make decision ourselves how it was, but how to explain computer. And we need to use this variety of algorithms to combine them together. And this is actually very, very difficult. And any artifact of scratch processing is also very difficult. There is, by the way, other problem, which is not about identification of scratches, but even if we find it correctly, and if we remove it, and if scratch goes through vertical objects or some kind of slope or objects, you have a good chance to have artifacts somewhere, to see it, especially in video. We will not talk about this problem today, about solution, but actually it's also somehow improved, and you will see all together this. So, what happened for last years? Each mod combined in green button, its efficiency, its protection from artifact went up very fast, and scratches removal were behind. So, probably I can say if you have probability of artifact higher than 10%, that's probability of good decision is 90%, probably we can think about adding this mod to combo filter to work together. Using regular technology, regular computer ideas, we could not reach this. And only artificial intelligence give us a chance to improve this. So, typical factors for gross efficiency in film restoration or image restoration. Of course, motion estimation is behind everything. So, different methods developed, and we rewrite our motion estimation algorithm practically each 2 years. Classical signal image processing, it's some kind of mathematics, it's harmonic analysis, it's a study tools how to represent images and how to manipulate with them. It's a standard what developed during, I don't know, 50 years, 60 years, maybe 70 years. Some new tools from classical methods, system for representation, like wavelets, they added huge progress in image processing just because it's very convenient tool, adequate tool for to represent images. So. Standard statistical methods also are very important because we process something, we measure something, we have to make decisions. Again, this is the classics, this is not artificial intelligence. Last year's compressed sensing algorithms, it's again about compact representation of images. Images, a few million of pixels. We cannot operate directly. We need to represent it not only for compression, but for processing. And compressed sensing algorithm gave some push and development of a signal processing algorithm. And finally, deep learning. And yeah, I'm going to talk about deep learning or artificial intelligence, what now is practically the same. So I am going to first give the introduction to deep learning, then some, I will mention some technology which already used, and we cannot already miss this technology because everything around goes up and very fast. And then screen some results, and we will discuss future. I think Mike will help me to discuss the future. So what is deep learning? It's a branch of machine learning. This is some kind of not algorithm, but rather system architectures, which allows to avoid routine programming or creating algorithms. Algorithms, methods, studying of objects are somewhere inside of computer system. So computer system can allow to create a method of processing with, in fact, no human intervention in this. The main tool of artificial intelligence, at least right now, is based on neural networks. Successes of neural networks and generally artificial intelligence, of course, absolutely enormous, you know, all of this, it's self-driving cars, medical diagnostics, speech recognition, I don't know, character recognition, even handwritten. It's fantastic how it works, and it works already very reliable. Now, a little bit about technique. History, by the way, history of neural network started quite long ago. In the 40s, first model of a neuron appeared, and neuron in that paper from 1943, it was described some mathematical object which was intended to be a model of a regular biological neuron. In much later, in the 50s, in the end of 50s, some system which is called hardware system, which is called perceptron, was invented, and neuron was used. They tune neurons to make some decisions. So it's in fact the first example of artificial intelligence. At that time, it was huge optimism. New York Times had paper where I explained that it's absolutely new time in the world. Machines now will walk, talk, to do whatever instead of us. But actually nothing happened, except for hard work. Hard work of people who worked in artificial intelligence, some science which existed in brain of engineers, but it was absolutely useless at that time, I think. And only 2014, 2015, suddenly, not very suddenly, but after big work, really, many people worked on this, some systems for recognition, classification, for making decisions appear. And you know about all of them, including self-driving cars and systems of image recognition. So what are reasons of this success at that time? Not 20 years ago, not 50 years ago, 3 years ago. It's a combination of hardware development, mainly because of NVIDIA GPUs, other systems, hardware, big data. Here I mean not only algorithm of big data, but rather huge sets of images or data were collected at one place. Say millions of images, labeled images, where each image has some kind of metadata showing what is there, to teach computers to recognize them. It was impossible, I don't know, 15 years ago. Algorithm, of course, but this is not main part of the success of artificial intelligence. And finally, money came to this area. It was 2015, not big amount, but it grows every year. It's really huge success. So what is neuron first? It's elementary brick for neural network. On the left side, we have biological neuron. On the right side, we have mathematical neuron. You can see there that we have input numbers x. Sorry for mathematics, but I'll try to do not torture too long. But it's at the beginning. It's very simple. So we have input of those numbers. We multiply it by numbers w, which are called weights of neuron. Then we add them together, and maybe add some number b there. And what is important, after all, we apply some function, which is non-linear. What is inside is linear function. Multiply by number and add something. And then apply something, really something, non-linear. And this is neuron. That's it, how it was created in 1943. So what next? We don't know what coefficients are there. So neuron accepts data, input data, and output some number. This number goes to other neurons, like system, like regular life is organized, quite similar. So on the left side, we have input layer. For example, we have three numbers, three pixels or whatever. We collect information from the three pixels and move it to the upper circle. This is one neuron. Neurons form layer, different neurons combine information and output as layers. Now we have different number of points. We select ourselves how many outputs, how many neurons we have. We have next layer. Next layer is used for forming next layer, and so on and so on. This is how regular neural work, network work. Then we have output. Output usually a few numbers. We will discuss a little bit later what those numbers are. Usually those numbers are like scores. Neural, in the simplest form, neural network has to identify the longness of input to some cluster, to some set. For example, inputs, pictures of dogs, cats, rabbits, okay? And system has to recognize and to say in the end that, okay, 65% this is rabbit, 15% is dog. How much left?
Right.
Oh. 20% cat. Okay, so probably we will make decisions as it was rabbit. Okay? Now, what happens if it's not? Because in the beginning, we initialize our weights with random numbers, how it works. Then we have, in the end, system told us this is a rabbit, but we see this is a cat. We have labeled system, so we have metadata, it's a cat. So what we do? We try to teach system that this is wrong, and we know how wrong it is. We want to get 100 for cats and 0 for rabbits and dogs. So we organize this error and set it back. This is the core of neural network training. It's called backpropagation. We send error. Mathematicians tell us this is gradient method, back gradient method. Send signal to change a little bit weights. To change a little bit, we go back and run system again. It works already, probably it works already better, but not good enough. We punish it again. This is, everything is about punishment. No word for this. You know, actually, I think you know very well how it works. Can you put louder speaker for? So after all, we have some testing set, which allows us to check how network is trained already. And this is what happens is something like this. May you set speaker loud?
It's all the way up.
Oh, sorry. Let me back. I'll try here.
Raise the volume on the computer.
I try to do it. Oh, a little bit.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
Again.
Actually,
the rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
I think she's got it. Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain.
And where?
Okay, I think you know. Now, let's back to mathematics. So, next. We have some set of labeled data, say here it's red and blue points. What the system has to do? It has to separate them into regions, and after algorithm, neural network has algorithm, it separate blue and red, and after all, on one side of curve, we will say that all points are blue, on other side are red. Again, it's nonlinear functions. Curve could be quite complicated. And neural network performs this operation. What happens inside neural network? You see here, it's a very toy example, two-dimensional. Each data element to numbers, to dimensional case. Image, okay, at least 100,000 dimension. So we cannot put image, it's strange, sounds strange, right? We cannot explain with images, but with very simple point. What happens behind the scene? Nonlinear function, imagine that this is a rubber plane. It's just apply some deformation to this plane, such that blue points go, say, up, red points goes up. So we take plane two dimensional, put in 3D space, and then we can easily define plane between them and say, okay, everything under plane is red, everything above plane is in the blue. So system are trained and make very simple decision, okay? And we didn't participate because spectral propagation did it and tuned bulk coefficient. It's our example, okay, here you see three sets, green, blue, and red points. They are labeled points. We give it random points to system. And system has to separate them with some curves, with some lines. Because when we have this solution, after all, we can take an arbitrary point and system will say, this point is green, this point is red. But in the beginning, only those discrete points are known. And how it works, I usually watch this like a magic. Again, toy example, but now a little bit more complicated. How it works. You see, system is looking the best solution to separate three quite complicated sets. Okay? It's different, three different neural networks. And they're working in different way. It's part of problem, but it's our selection, how to create architecture of neural network. Here we have just different, those non-linear so-called activation functions. Okay?
Is there gonna be a test after this?
Sure. In Chipotle. Okay. Again, different systems are working in different way. In the beginning, you see that the right side works faster, but suddenly, and again, it looks like magic. One friend of mine thought, okay, what's the point? I can do it for instantly. Why we need to use computer to separate the set? I said, you are 70 years old, and this system is 20 seconds old. It already can do something. And this is really fantastic. Okay, for images, everything is a little bit more complicated. Because with images, we don't have to collect entire information from image, we need to pick up some pieces of image. Images have local features, some edges, some, I don't know, rabbits, ears, whatever. So we need to analyze not entire image, but this small window. We collect this information with neuron, but now we have only local information. So we need to move this small window along horizontal lines, all horizontal lines, and cover entire image. And output here will be, say, blue rectangle on the right. Then we change neuron, we change coefficients. We allow to change coefficients and create a new so-called feature map, feature set. Then we collect this in 20, 30, maybe 60 feature maps. And then this will be layer, convolutional layer of image analysis. Then those layers will serve as input for next layer. Then it goes to next layer, different number sets, and so on and so on. The more complicated problem we have, the more layers we need to create this fantastic nonlinear function which separates sets. And at the end, again, we have score, which will tell us who is there, linear or regular. The point is that we cannot understand what is inside. It's a big problem of artificial intelligence. But we can see something. For example, for images, if you try to see what kind of coefficients W after tuning, it turns out those small squares shows those coefficients. It was fantastic, it's absolutely offensive for mathematicians, because we, me, Inna, I think 100,000 mathematicians tried to create model of image and create system for image representation for the sensors. And we worked entire world, you know, 30-40 years on this. And this system is find those W's for maybe a few minutes. It's really offensive. So artificial intelligence creates, first it defines what features are important, what are not. It just learn the world like kids. Adults, they want to know rules, how to define their steps. This system trying to teach, to learn the world by examples. And finally, it creates its own system of features, which maybe we don't know. I'll explain later how it related to scratches, for example. So we need, for classical approach, we need to create system of features. We need to create how model of those features works. We need to know how to separate. It's a huge headache. It's a long process, and big labs may work on one such system months, years. And this works much faster. Now, let's go to scratches. First of all, we need to set labeled set. It's, by the way, very big problem because we need many scratches, different kinds of scratches. Here, Inna created about 100,000 labeled set. It's probably it's not enough yet, but it's already works. We know we can confirm that it works. Each vertical rectangle characterized is it, this is scratch or not? Is a black label, a yellow label means no scratch, and so 100,000 approximately. Then we have to create architecture for our network. Then we have to train it. Training procedure, we go forward and backward, how many times? In our case, it's 150,000 times. It works, I know, 15 hours, 24 hours, something like that. Self-driving car system working from very powerful computers, a few weeks. Is it a lot or not? You know, Moses trained his people 40 years. And self-driving car only 2 weeks. Not bad progress, yeah? What we have after that? We apply a just test. And we check whether a system is reliable or not. And then we apply already field test. Apply it, put it in releases, and so on. Okay, problems with this. First of all, okay, excellent nonlinear system. What could be headache for researchers? For neural network, it's trivial to create reliable, relatively reliable nonlinear system, which fit the given set of data. You can operate with this data, and next time you can adjust the same system to train it for absolutely different data, relatively fast. Even 2 weeks, it's offline. It's not, because after training, solution can be made practically, decision can be made practically instantly. Very fast prediction, it learns a feature itself, and it can be made in parallel with GPUs. It's fantastic. What is bad? We don't know what is inside. So we are trying to know what is inside, but sometimes it's not quite clear, and no guarantee in success. We see statistically that success is great, but it's just still. So something bad may happen, actually.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
When you come to field test.
But in Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen.
How awfully funny.
What is wrong with that, young man? I bet I got it right.
Smashing.
Hasn't it suddenly turned chilly?
I do hope we won't have any unseasonable cold spells. They bring on so much influenza, and the whole of our family is susceptible to it.
My aunt died of influenza, so they said. But it's my belief they've done the old woman in.
Done her in? Yes, Lord love you. Why should she die of influenza when she come through diphtheria right enough the year before? Fairly blue with it she was. They all thought she was dead, but my father, he kept ladling gin down her throat. Oh. Then she come to so sudden, she bit the bowl off the spoon.
Dear me.
Now what call would a woman with that strength in her have to die of influenza? And what become of her new straw hat that should have come to me? Somehow pinched it. And what I say is, them as pinched it, done her in.
Okay, so, but how to fight the problem like this? First of all, database has to get larger and larger. If you remember my toy example, dynamic toy example, you see that points do not fill entire space, so not enough. So decision how to separate those points, it's not unique. Different systems use different solutions, and actually it's some kind of unavoidable. You can create better or worse, but if you don't have enough big enough training set, it's not good. And other way to increase stability of system, just apply both artificial intelligence and all methods inside. So what we are doing actually, how it works. And by the way, everyone is welcome to send us their samples of their sophisticated, nice scratches, because it's also for development. But now actually everything is very easy. We have bigger database, we just run system for tuning and just replace with release one file with those coefficients, which can do hopefully better and better in scratch recognition. So now you can select in a program, just use artificial intelligence check, or don't use, if you want to use, you can select among two ways, two neural networks. I'm going to show a few examples, a few clips. This is not only about recognition. Frankly, I don't know how to show, how to demonstrate good recognition of scratches, because it's, I don't know. So this is about our dream, how to, small dream, put scratches inside combo filter. This is not yet. We run scratches and then everything else. Okay, so all samples. No manual work, no human work at all. It's just everything is automatic. This is one pass, in fact. This sample we got from Fixer Film from Wojtek Janya. And problem was, scratch is red. We created models. Scratch has to be either dark or light if it's base, or if it's emulsion, it's green or blue. But this is red. System doesn't work. System doesn't work to recognize that this is scratch. So our feature space is not good enough. It's necessary to redo something. We found some way around, but anyway, this is okay. Problem that scratch is red here. So look at it closer. It's a fact dark, but different, a little bit different in different channels. But red color doesn't allow to recognize with traditional means. Okay, we can write a new algorithm which works specially for red scratches, but it's not good solution. Otherwise, we will rewrite algorithm maybe a few months for each type of scratch. It doesn't work this way. But now, artificial intelligence system recognizes it instantly. We even don't know what kind of features it selected and why it decided that everything is okay. But it said, yeah, everything is okay. So by the way, the second problem, of course, is how to repair scratches invisibly. And again, it's topic for separate lecture, but here I'd like to demonstrate everything on clips. But this is not about topic of this talk itself. So, just a moment. Okay. It's removed scratch. Short, very short clip.
Rosa?
And a few clips for different type of scratches. Next one is black and white. Black and white, of course, is most complicated because much less features for scratch identification. Okay. I didn't show sample. So you see on the right side scratch which goes through vertical construction and such type is usually very complicated, such type of scratches. For identification, to avoid false identification, and also because of those vertical constructions. Okay. This scratch is gone. I believe no. Visible, at least very visible damage of image. Next is blue scratch. Here scratch is can be identified quite easily. Actually, it's emulsion scratch, but it goes through a lot of vertical construction again. And the question is how to accurately repair the image here. And of course, we have many frames, and it has to be found. Any frame, not 90%. 90% here, of course, is not enough. Oh, no. Oh, still unreliable on Mac. It's some kind of home video. You see scratch goes through blue element of bicycle and still no visible damage. Now, this is standard definition. This is high definition. This is a green scratch. Quite visible green scratch on the left. Oh, plus a lot of artifacts of the image. Short clip. I just show different kind of. Okay, and could you please run now DCP of two. This is one of film 1973, Don't Look in the Basement, and second one will be Laughing Gas from Thomas Edison Company. Can you run this if you? The first piece, it's, I don't know, 5-6 scratches of different intensity. And the second is much more. So, yeah, absolutely. No operator work at all. The guy who restored this film, it's from Brink DVD, he did restoration the first time. We did it ourselves for this demo, but actually it was restored for DVD a few months ago. The guy who did it tried to restore something for his company the first time.
You see, original,
I don't know for sure because we just had a digital sample which is on the left. So, because it's dark scratches, it's definitely positive. Okay, this laughing gas.
Thanks to Image Protection Services and MoMA.
Here from 20 to 40 frames, scratches per frame. Actually, some of them are practically invisible, but they are there. And a lot of vertical elements here, pay attention. So again, the problem not only to identify if this is scratch or not scratch. What neural network is doing quite well. But the second problem, if scratch goes through those vertical elements, to do not damage.
Yeah, we had to block off the door frames there where the vertical lines were coming through. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it would wipe out part of the door frame.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. Everything is one pass, except for the scratch. The scratch goes before. But hopefully, quite soon, it will be in the same pass. One output. It's 1907.
Just to give you an idea, the processing time on this is 4K. It took 24 hours to process about 10 minutes with two super GPUs, 16-core, and eight super SDS terabyte storage. Fantastic.
Of course, here it's a little bit aggressive, but you know, input materials, of course, quite damaged, so aggressive processing. Go. It's a short film. We'll show 3 minutes of this film, and entire film is shown 10 minutes.
Somebody might talk about the fact that there's no grain, that you don't have the film sense on the right because we wiped out a lot of grain. We're since now taking less grain on some of the stuff, but allowing the client to make those decisions.
So broadly speaking, some numbers first of all, and Sean, thanks for adding some color to that, so to speak. We have, with the training of these neural networks, we're at about 98.5% accuracy, which means that we're finding 98 or more out of 100 scratches in a frame,
1.5% of error.
1.5% of error. That is something that will get less and less as we train the system more. As you heard, we put 60 to 80,000 test images through this. We want to put more in. So the appeal to you, please, of sending us your scratches, and by the way, it's not just scratches, it's also images of vertical structure that you may have used other products with where it gets confused to be a scratch, because both of those are errors, right? Removing something that shouldn't be removed or missing something that should be removed are both things we want to train this further for. But I hope what you've gotten is a sense that this technology, even though I don't expect you to remember it's the weight times the input plus the bias through a nonlinear function in three layers, you know, that's not the key part here. The key part here is that there's a lot of money and technology evolving this space, and if we can collaborate to train these well, they can do far better than a human can using the kind of heuristic rules we come up with to say a scratch must be vertical, must be black, it must be this many pixels, and having to have all these other rules. The system learns on its own far better than we know how to do this. And the results are awfully darn good as a starting place either for pristine restoration or as a very reasonable, modest price restoration. And it will get cheaper and cheaper. So we're going to keep working on the algorithmic side of things. It's going to come through all the things Alex mentioned, especially better motion estimation and continued training of these kinds of things. But we believe the promise is bright. The general availability of deep learning to these kind of technologies, and it's not just scratches, that's where we started, right? I remember in the early days when you were talking about removing dirt, that the issue of separating out dirt during a snowstorm, or you know, the glint off the diamond earring in a key part of a scene that gets removed because it looks like a piece of white dirt, is the kind of thing that we can train these systems to make better and better decisions on. And that's where the promise is, because we've got a lot of films to save collectively around the world, and this is going to be a really important part. So that's what we have to say. Thanks so much to our sponsors, to The Real Thing. Great work these guys have done. If you all have any questions, Enid, can you join us?
Question here.
In your initial training data, were you given any information about which things had scratches, or was it clustering entirely? Determining how to cluster into scratched and non-scratched entirely by itself?
Just each image of a scratch, long piece, just labeled as is a scratch. Actually, it's labeled is a dark scratch, or is a light scratch, is a green, or is a blue. But finally, we understood that now it's not important even.
And no scratch.
And no scratch. Different class. Different cluster.
I have
approximately
a question.
Equal number.
Yeah, hi. Any idea on cost, what this will wind up costing, the software or the hardware for that matter? Thanks.
That's probably, I don't think we want to be commercial, but
yeah.
You can certainly ask about pricing. Most of these systems will run on GPU-centric PCs in the $10,000 range or so. For very high end.
$1,200
for the
high end.
Okay.
$1,200
for the
hardware. Computer.
For
the hardware.
Plus
the software.
The software.
Plus monitor. Of course, monitor is very strict.
Yeah.
But
$1,200
computer is fast enough to work.
Sure.
That's
I can answer part of that. Sure. So the monitor that we used was the Dreamcolor monitor. The monitor that we used there was the Dreamcolor monitor, which was monitor of the year at NAB in 2015. That was $2,300. The computer that we used was $18,000. That was, like I said, two super GPUs, 8 terabytes, and it had 16 cores in it. Again, it was 4K to start, and the final, what you saw there, well, that's been stepped on a bunch of times. So we're sitting about $24,000 just in hardware. Without eating the sandwich or turning the light bulb on, and then of course the software. I'll let them.
But this is high-end system. You.
Well, but yeah. Most of the people in this room that are sitting at archives and stuff would want to be working at 4K. I would assume to be doing this a lot of this work. So that you can get it done at that price.
We work with computers where it was developed 1200.
Okay.
Yeah.
You'd still be processing.
Depends on your turnaround time, your renderer farm, etc. You can spend a lot on computing, but it will run on something.
Well, storage can be very expensive, yeah. And if you want to do something fast, yeah.
I have another question here. This will prove how little I know. Each installation has to be trained?
No, everything is trained in our lab, and then you just use it and you can forget about this.
It's like the self-driving car. They're investing weeks and weeks and weeks in determining the weights, the biases, and the nonlinear transforms by training it. And then that code, there's a difference between training and implementing. As Alex said, it's virtually instantaneous to compute and categorize whether something's a scratch or not. But it took 16 hours to come up with all the numbers that get preloaded into that formula, if you will. So. The decision making is instant, but the training is done, and then a software release is put out anytime there's a major improvement.
I have a question over here.
Hi, great presentation. My question is, obviously a lot of the work you're doing now is based on GPU coprocessors. Earlier in the presentation, you were talking about the tensor processors and TensorFlow architectures.
Yes,
earlier in the presentation, not you right now, but I've been sort of looking at sort of non-von Neumann type architectures, what they'll look like. And do you you see, I mean, I see that there are a number of new coprocessors that could have some real impact, not only in accelerating these sorts of algorithms, but also perhaps dealing with things that we couldn't do before to improve the quality. And I'm wondering if you've done enough yet with the TensorFlow systems or subsystems to know, can these things be used in combination? Is that your thought? And where some things would be done with GPU and other things like preferences and stuff might make more sense in a TensorFlow situation because it's a deeper neural network. Just curious.
So far, the main problem is our understanding how to make it work better. Not GPU. Because, okay, we can afford 15, 16 hours of tuning and what else? On a customer computer, it will work a few frames a second, so.
And if I may, I'm gonna answer a question you didn't quite ask, but as an ex-ops and tech guy, you know, when we started doing restoration, all the work was that we did everything on the Apple platform because everything was floating point and the Apple did great floating point work. And one of the challenges to running that operation was how often do you buy new computers? Because you're spending $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 every time you're replacing each element of your render farm, it's really expensive. And what was really transformative for us, and what's true of Viva and its implementation as well, is when you do the processing on a graphics card, you now only need to replace that one board in your computer. And so when a new $300 graphics card doubles the speed of your computer and you don't need a new backplane, you don't need a new CPU, you don't need new disk drives, you basically get free extra capacity. So staying within the gaming world's platforms for that affordability, I think for most applications, high-end CG, it may not be, you know, may not be true, but you know, for most of us who are trying to get renders as cheap as possible, I think working in the mid-range, you know, mid-range and using consumer GPUs is going to be the sweet spot for quite a while.
$500-$700 GPU. Now it's optimal. At least, if it's more powerful, it will not be just so efficient, probably because of problem of exchange of information, because there's some compressed video and so on. So GPU is not the main obstacle.
We have one over here.
It's the time of controlling. This will be the last one. I guess not so much a question as a comment. So for over 25 years, I guess, that we've been doing these kinds of, this kind of work, meaning digital restoration, kind of the holy grail has always been the automated process. Not so much to take the human intervention out of it, but to make it more objective and to lower the cost. It's very expensive when everything has to be done manually. And that's a big part of it. But the problem with automated processes like this, and like virtually every automated process, is that you want it to attack the specific problem and leave everything else alone. So, and what I see up here on these samples is that this, and admittedly the laughing gas one is an extreme example because you have to wipe out the entire image before to fix it. But not so much on that one where the basement was in the title of it. What we're looking for really is an automated process that will remove the scratch, and scratches are virtually the hardest thing to fix in terms of damage, and leave the rest of the image alone. And the fact is that every one of those examples, and Sean alluded to it in terms of that last one up there, the fix almost looks like a still image if the characters weren't moving. And it's because the entire image has been affected by the processing. Mm-hmm. So what I guess my question is, are we going to a point where we can really define the process and the processing to the specific image? Because otherwise, I know there are other processes, post-processes, that attack what I'm talking about, like degraining and regraining. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't fix the problem. That not the solution. That's a camouflaging the problem. So, so I guess I'll let you take it from there.
Let me take a first crack, and then Alex can add. First of all, you're absolutely right, and tomorrow I think we have a presentation that's going to talk about the ethics and aesthetics of restoration as well. You know, there are things that, like scratches and dirt, which we don't debate, generally speaking, whether we should remove. And then there are things like grain and image structure and sharpness and those sorts of things where it's an aesthetic choice. And we need to separate those two. And it's really the subject of a whole nother conversation. But when you repair dirt and scratches, in an ideal world, you want to do it in a low grain or no grain environment because the repair gets much more complicated if you're doing it in a grainy environment. And then you're left with putting the grain or other features back in. And one of the things that is being built into this system now is, in fact, having a creative back end where you can say, all right, I want all my grain back. I want 80% of my grain back. I want half of my coarse grain back and all of my fine grain back.
No, what we don't want is it removed to begin with. And I know that's the challenge. Well, I know that.
Understood. To be able to uncover and detect the stuff, you have to do some pre-processing. But understood. And there may be some answers in there. I think it's something we need to keep looking at. But
it works without removing the grain. We're running
right.
All kinds of tests on this processing wise by using the combo filters at different levels and using them in sequence.
It's tunable. Remaining grain is tunable. Yeah. Just a general rule, I think it's true for any system. The higher damage of initial footage, the less chance to preserve fine grain. But it can be returned, it can be returned native grain. And the second, of course, all this combo filter can be separated in different passes. Everything separate exists in system. So if you want, just disconnect one click and you will have only scratch removal or whatever.
And I think the thing Sean said is important. I'm not sure everyone heard it, which is that you can remove the scratches and you can remove dirt without making significant, possibly even any changes to the grain. They are independent knobs. It's just that for processing efficiency, if you know where you're going, it's often done as one. As Alex said, that reduces storage and all those sorts of things. So it isn't necessarily true. You can't do any of the other automated features unless you're degraining the picture.
And there are no other questions, so thank you.
Okay, thanks, and we'll be